This episode of the Old Dogs REI Network is brought to you by Mino Studio. Welcome to the Old Dogs REI Network, where cash flow is king. Real estate investing, the means, so you can enjoy your retirement dreams. This is the show where we cut right to the chase. No sales pitch, no long monologues, just simple how-to real estate investing advice so you can earn the passive income you need to enjoy your retirement today. And now, your host and chief old dog, Bill Manicero.
Hello, old dogs, and welcome to
Fun Facts Friday.
This is our once a week, only on Friday show, where we have special episodes not featuring guests, where I will share tricks, tips, terminology, and techniques that will help skyrocket you to real estate investing success. Today's topic is, will value-add investing work in 2021? But before we get started, hey, just touching base with you guys and hoping everybody's doing good. Okay, this is a new year and I'm hoping that we are just like cranking it in terms of searching for properties, looking for markets, looking for deals. There are a lot of new deals coming on the market and you just have to know where to look and look in the right place. So don't be discouraged. Okay. There's some great opportunities out there. And if you don't see them yet, you will because they're coming on the market. So, hey, let me jump into the tip of the week here. Tenant retention, big thing, important thing. You know, some landlords say you don't even make money the first year of having a tenant there. It's not until they renew their lease that you actually start making money. If they keep doing that every year, you're making a lot more money. So it's really important that you can keep tenants at least a year, at least 2 years. I wouldn't even say just a year, 2 year minimum. And shoot for 3 years. And I would even put on your applications, how long do you think you're going to stay? I mean, that may not mean anything. They might put down anything, but at least it can open the conversation. And I've been looking for, with tenants in my properties, is looking for longevity. It's really key. So here's a good one, okay? Do not punish bad tenants without rewarding your good ones. So sometimes the bad tenants get all the attention, right? But it's the wise landlord who recognizes the good tenants with something of value for being good, right? If you are already a landlord or will be in the future, sooner or later you will receive a call from another landlord verifying the background on one of your good tenants. But then it's too late, right? The extra time that tenant was with you, the rent was always paid on time, the apartment was always kept nice and clean, there was never a complaint. As a matter of fact, you forgot they even existed. But that's why they're moving, okay? Give your good tenants simple rewards to show them you appreciate them. And here are a few inexpensive ways to just show good tenants that you care for them. And believe me, it's something that will pay off in the long run. For example, a turkey at Thanksgiving. Or maybe, you know, you're going to offer to paint a room for them. Maybe they want a different look or something. Maybe even put a new carpet in one of the rooms. I know that sounds kind of expensive, but boy, it is certainly a lot less expensive than the cost of turning over a unit every year. So these are things that you might want to think of. This is a valued group, and I think they deserve, you know, good attention from you. You could even give them, you know, a certificate for ice cream down the street, or a gift card, you know, to maybe a restaurant that happens to be in the area that they might like, or you know, just a gift card for some store that they might get a lot of value out of. But they will really look at that, and that will really mean a lot to them. I mean, these are just a couple of things. It's not just bribery, but it's also, you know, just checking in on them every now and then. How are you doing? Do you need anything? Do you have any issues that need to be fixed? Anything like that? Are people responding well? Especially if you have a property manager, you know, it's not a bad idea to send somebody in there to just to survey your people, you know, every quarter and just to make sure that they're doing all right. So these little things will really help with your tenant retention numbers. They'll respect you. Your turnover rate will be much lower. All right, let's start with our topic. Will value add investing work in 2021? Now, value add is probably a familiar term to many of you guys, but not all. So I promise I'll try and give you kind of an overview here. First, let's look at what is value add investing. The simplest way I can explain it really is it's buying an asset that has a known return on investment, ROI, and meaningfully improving some aspect of the property in a way that the ROI on the improvements is much higher than the ROI on the asset as a whole. In other words, raising the average ROI on the entire project, which means increasing the value of the property. Value-add multifamily projects can entail a wide range of business plans depending on the target tenant, the building size, and investors' competencies. Experienced value-add investors also closely consider how much renovation risk they are willing to accept and how much they can feasibly spend per unit. Now, I'm a value-add investor, and I've been doing it pretty much since I started, even with small properties. I like to get a hold of a property, do some improvements to it, and I know that I've already increased the equity in that property. With smaller properties, four units and under, it's not necessarily going to have a big impact on the total value of the property. Of course, it's going to affect the value, but not to the degree it does with the multifamily. And this is an area where a lot of multifamily investors are and have been involved in value-add investing for a number of years. Generally, what you do with a value-add is, just to give an example, you find an apartment, generally 1980s and newer. It's got some things that that are maybe outdated. Maybe just the apartments in general could use just a facelift and maybe new cabinets, maybe new countertops, maybe put in vinyl planking on the floor, getting rid of the carpet, things like that. Doing some exterior upgrades, and of course you're going to paint and maybe do some exterior work. Generally, you can do a lot with paint without having to really do any major changes. But sometimes you're going to do some facial work on it that'll make it look a little bit more presentable or more modern. That may also include adding amenities too, like a dog park or bike stations, outdoor barbecue picnic areas, things like that. And when you do these kinds of things, one of the good things that happens is that people see the improvements, they realize that they're improving the building. Well, you can also increase rents at that time. When you increase rents, of course, your ROI is going to go up, and with your ROI increasing, your value goes up. Note that the value-add play is not the only way to profitably invest in commercial multifamily units. One could also invest in like a new development or even stabilized properties or unstabilized properties where you just have to bring in a good property manager, momentum plays, or other opportunities that do very well. However, this investment strategy was significantly jolted by the pandemic-related shutdowns. So how strong is the segment now? Can you still use this strategy? Well, the practice of purchasing an unperforming multifamily asset at a discount, implementing significant renovations and raising rental prices has grown in popularity over the last several years. I remember when I first started investing, I was hearing about it just a little bit, and then all of a sudden it seemed like everybody was doing it in the apartment sphere. But like much else in the multifamily industry, value-add investment suddenly became the subject of uncertainty when COVID-19 took hold in early 2020. Value-add apartment sales totaled $32 billion in transaction volume in 2018, 16% of the multifamily deals, according to Real Capital Analytics. But the unpredictability of the pandemic caused many investors to pull back deals or pause and to re-examine their business strategies. The second quarter represented the lowest multifamily investment sales for any quarter in almost a decade. Now, again, that's expected. People didn't know what was going to happen, and they pulled back. With the end of the year in sight, multifamily investment activity overall appears to be back on track. During the third quarter, sales totaled $24 billion, a 55.9% increase from the previous quarter. Still, conditions are making buyers more careful in how and where they are choosing to make deals. In a recent article by Multihousing News, experts from major brokerage firms and value-added investment firms were surveyed about how things have changed since March, how the value-add market now compares to last year, and the markets attracting the most deals at the moment. Jeanette Rice, a real estate economist and head of multifamily research at CBRE, noted that activity in the value-add segment never completely stopped during the global health crisis. She's seen closings rise since July and expects the most recent numbers to be even higher. However, in the early days of the pandemic, there were moments of uncertainty among investors. And this is Jeanette talking. She says, early on, we did see value-add buyers really sort of pause because we weren't sure what would happen with rents, said Rice. While the buyers have returned, activity isn't quite back to the level it was before COVID-19. And large gateway cities are feeling the pain more than other cities, with Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, Seattle, and especially San Francisco and New York underperforming. Colliers International Vice President Kala Espinoza recently closed a $65 million sale in Reno, Nevada that was the metro's largest value-add transaction in more than a decade. The property, a 300-unit apartment community in West Reno, was first brought to market in 2019, and Espinoza reports generated tons of interest. Despite concern about the pandemic, the deal got done. Well, Espinoza says investors and owners of value-add properties had stretched out their timelines and are pulling back on renovation spending, Espinoza's markets, Northern California and Northern Nevada, have performed well over the last several months. Investors are looking at more a secondary and tertiary markets now, where there's a lower cost of living but still an attractive job market, said Espinoza. The pandemic has not only affected real estate investing, but for many people, it may have caused their dream of one day owning a home to remain just that, a dream. That is why I'm very excited to introduce a new sponsor on our show called Equity and Help, which allows you to invest in real estate while also helping out a family who wants to see that dream become a reality. While investments in real estate have proven their stability, averaging returns of about 8%, an investment with Equity and Help will give you not only the best security for your financial future, but an even better return, averaging 8% to 12%, where you can generate cash flow while leaving a legacy. Now, what if your investment helped not only you, the investor, but hardworking American families in the process? At Equity and Help, they make the process easy by locating properties and finding the perfect family for a home that they might not otherwise have the chance to own. That is investing with purpose outside of turning a profit. Interested? Call Sky Logan, your philanthro investor consultant from Equity and Help at 844-552-8828 or visit equityandhelp.com to learn more. That's Sky Logan at 844-552-8828 or visit equityandhelp.com to learn more. In response to changing conditions, Prism Multifamily Group tweaked its value-add strategy for Las Vegas. Before the pandemic, the firm was in the midst of upgrading its B-minus portfolio in the market to the B-plus level. Occupancy was high, as was demanded for renovated units. But renters had become price sensitive and aren't looking to spend more for upgraded units. We were doing really well in our value add execution, said Mark Zolte, president and founder of the Toronto-based investor, which operates in markets across the U.S. His firm chose to hold back on more renovations in Las Vegas for the time being and push back new upgrades in the metro by 12 to 18 months. This market is really hurting as far as income is concerned, so we might as well have a product that meets what the consumer is looking for, said Zolte. Meanwhile, the COVID-19 pandemic has had little impact on Prism's upgrade program in South Florida, where the firm is still seeing ample demand and actively pursuing projects. We stopped in April. We weren't sure which way the market was going, he said. By June, we realized we had strong demand, so we might as well continue renovating. After an initial pause, deals are flowing again, and investors are looking for opportunities. Metros getting the most attention now already have strong fundamentals before COVID-19 and have been less impacted than other areas. With low cost of capital and greater stability in the market, investors will look to implement value-add renovation plans sooner rather than later, says Ty Cohen, a senior director in the Sunbelt Multifamily Advisory Group at Cushman & Wakefield. There was a small pause in April where people were holding off, but it feels like that has changed and people are doing value add as quick as possible, said Cohen. In his market, which includes Metro Charleston, South Carolina, the first quarter of 2020 was the biggest ever for his team, followed by an extremely slow second quarter and a very active third quarter. Right now, we're probably as active as more than last year, said Cohen, adding the potential of capital gains changing post-election, historically cheap debt, liquidity, and popularity of the Sun Belt are the drivers of the activity. Espinosa's markets include the booming Reno-Sparks region, which has proven to be an attractive alternative for renters looking for good jobs and a lower cost of living than in Silicon Valley. However, the markets with the most straw have been those where rents were climbing. Value add is really popular when there's pressure on upward rents on a market. And right now, rents in Reno and Northern California are either staying flat or in some places declining, she said. Instead, markets where population growth is exerting upward pressure on rents, like Boise, Idaho, Austin, Texas, and Raleigh-Durham, North Carolina, are still proving to be the most popular with investors. Topaz Capital Group, which invests in value-add properties in southeastern markets, is continuing its value-add plans, though with some adjustments. The firm will implement upgrades over longer periods, increasing the minimum occupancy threshold, and focus on exterior renovations while monitoring leasing traffic. There's a lot more studying we're doing now as opposed to the past, which we were more confident, needing less studying and meticulous analysis, said Topaz's managing partner and CEO, Mark Hirschberg. We're definitely combing over how units are being absorbed in the marketplace. There's no way of knowing when the pandemic will subside and how the multifamily market will be affected next year by the economic downturn, widespread loss of jobs, eviction moratoriums, and rent collection struggles. That said, industry veterans expect the market to perform well in 2021. I think there's a lot of pent-up demand, which is part of the reason the multifamily market is so active right now, said Cohen. So many people sat on the sidelines in Q3 and Q4 last year. I think Q4 this year will be more active than last year, and I think we'll see historic numbers all through next year. The prospect of another major lockdown during the winter months is something that could potentially have a huge impact on the multifamily market and, in turn, value-add segment, said Espinosa of Colliers International. Class A and Class B properties would stay relatively resilient, but properties with a high proportion of residents employed by hotels, casinos, and restaurants could take a significant hit. Another factor is the cost of construction, which has been on the rise for some time. That has been the case for at least 5 years in the Northern California and Reno, Nevada regions, where Espinosa's work is focused. The last conversation I've had with developers, they're pulling back with developing, stopping, maybe waiting it out, she said. Other developers are saying they're actually seeing signs that maybe construction costs will trail downward. But I'd say right now they're still incredibly high. So many developers are shovels down, just kind of waiting it out to see what happens. So is value add going to still work? Well, there's a lot of people that are optimistic, as you can see. There's also a lot of people that are very, very skeptical and wondering what's going to happen. And I think some of the adjustments being made were actually made before COVID hit. You went from seeing sort of your three-year holds on some of these value add deals to five-year, then 5 to 7. And I talked to now investors that are looking at being prepared for a 10-year hold and some even longer. So there are some adjustments being made. But again, the values are still very, very high. And I think that that's got to come down before we can really see some energy in the value add side. And whether or not it'll work or not will depend a lot on whether or not these lockdowns are going to be reality or whether or not there are going to be other restrictions on investors. Well, that's it for today. Please note, old dog listeners, everything presented here today, and there will be some links also, can be accessed in our show notes on the Old Dogs website at olddogsreinetwork.com/blog. And you're going to look for the episode entitled, Will Value Add Investing Work in 2021? So until next time, remember, cash flow is king and real estate investing the means. Until next time, keep moving forward, and may God bless.
Thank you very much for visiting the Old Dogs REI Network. We would greatly appreciate if you would stop by iTunes and let us know what you think of the show. We would love if you could subscribe to the podcast, give us a 5-star rating, and write a review. The more ratings and reviews we receive, the more visible the podcast will be to others. Thank you.